Good morning.
Good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to see you here in the house of the Lord today. As you can tell, we have a smaller crowd than normal. That is because we have a lot of people that have been, nobody that I know of has contracted the disease, but we have people that have been in contact with people who have tested positive, and so they're doing the right thing, just trying to keep all of us safe. So they are at home watching online. We thank you guys for watching online, and please get into the service there just like you would here. People are continuing to come in, but we need to get started in our service today. Again, it's just wonderful to be in the house of the Lord. Thank you for coming. Would you stand this morning, and let's worship our King. We're going to sing How to Worship a King.
Intro. 2, 3.
You give me joy, you give me life, you give me strength to stand in the fire. Now I can live what I sing, showing the world how to worship a King. Let's worship Him today.
Lord,
God, I give you thanks. God, I
worship you today, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Turn to your neighbor and say, welcome to the house of the Lord today. Walls between us, by the cross you came and broke them down, you broke them down. There were chains all bound us, by your grace we are no longer bound, no longer bound. You call me out of the grave, you call me into the light, you call my name and then my heart came alive. And love is greater, love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Yes. I feel the darkness shaking, all the day. You're alive. You call me out of the grave, you call me into the light, you call my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens. Shout it out, we're alive, cause you're alive. What a love we found, death can't hold us down. We shout it out, we're alive, cause you're alive, Lord. What a love we found, death can't hold us down. We shout it out, we're alive, cause you're alive. One more time, sing it.
And love awakens, awakens, awakens me.
Amen. We're alive in Christ today. You can be seated.
Yeah, I know. Different face, right? Are they awesome? You know they've been here since 8:30 this morning. Getting ready for you guys. There's a lot of moving wheels. John has a lot of moving wheels. It takes a lot of people to get everything together. I just want you to know that. They do a great job. So as George Churchgoer, I got elected to do announcements. John appoints very well. There's nobody here to do announcements. Oh, well, you're elected. Okay. So you might have to help me with some of these. So the first one I have is the Connect With Us cards in the seats. Usually we're the, you got them there? Okay. All right. So we've been, if you need to connect with us or want to connect with us or have prayer requests, obviously fill those out, turn them in back there in the tithe box. Okay. And then next up we have the Bristles and Brushes ladies event. Am I saying that right? I should know that one, being my wife's
Bristles
part
and
of
brunch.
That.
Bristles and Brunch.
Bristles and Brush. Okay. Oh, brunch. See?
I need better
glasses. Brunch sounds better to me. It just skip the Bristles. Let's go to brunch. Anything you want to add to anything you want to add to that? You want to come and talk to them? Oh, I got a bad look on my face from that. All right, so let's move on. Next one is Family First for Christmas. Now, there's a number of things I've got itemized here. Is need names by today. Need to be turned in for that. And then also Target Dayton stockings, $50, correct?
Yes, they're taking up funds for their Christmas stockings.
And okay.
So, yeah, you can turn your money into the church office, and we'll take care of it from there.
And then the toys for tots as well. Is there not a...
We'll have a box back in the back, and they can bring toys and put them in the box.
Okay.
For the tots.
Great. See, John's going to help me out. and then next one up is Christmas invitations, and that's the Christmas play and Christmas Eve services that'll be coming up. And then, let's see, Lindsay Huggins on January 3rd at 6 p.m., okay? And supposedly she is absolutely awesome, so you want to make plans for that. And January 3rd is a Sunday night, correct?
Yes, sir.
So that changes things up for most people, okay? So you have to make sure you write that one down. And then I had somebody add one on here before I get to the very last one, was water donations. Hey, if you guys can make some, you know, with all the COVID stuff, we're not supposed to be using the drinking fountains and stuff like that. We like to put water bottles and stuff back there. If you wouldn't care to bring, just donate a pack of water that they can store and keep those out for people, okay, that would be wonderful. And then last but not least, let's have a closing prayer for tithe and offering. And we'll move on. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day, this time, and this space that you've given us. And we ask, Heavenly Father, for your blessing upon tithes and offerings, and that your rivers of grace may flow through those tithes and offerings. We ask in your name, Jesus, amen.
All right. Thank you, Greg. Would you stand? Let's just continue worshiping for a few moments.
One, two,
we want to enter into the presence of the Lord here today.
Grace has been enough.
And I believe that the best is yet to come. The cross before you, I hope on things above. And in you, Jesus, the best is yet to come.
Your presence. Responding to us as we've come to you with hearts of praise. We are grateful, Lord, for who you are, for what you mean to us. We have come today to honor you. There is none like you, Lord Jesus. Help us to know you, Lord, like we've never known you before. Apostle Paul did a lot of things. He accomplished a lot in his life. But he writes in the scriptures and he says that all of that he counts as loss as compared to the greatness of knowing Jesus. All I once held dear, build my life. Love you, Lord, because you are faithful to us. You keep your promises, Lord. Never fails to amaze. How when we call on you, Lord, you are faithful to respond. We feel your presence in this place today. By the power of your presence, Lord, in the authority of your name, we ask you to break the chains that bind us. We ask you to move into parts of our hearts and our lives that have never been touched before, because we've held them back from you. We want to offer them to you today. Knowing you, Lord, is enough. We should not desire anything more. We should not accept anything less than knowing you. You are the source of all life. Every good and perfect gift comes from you. Oh Lord, we praise you. Lord, we praise you. And now my heart's desire is to know said. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You could be seated.
That was good. That was good. So grateful to be in the house of the Lord. Psalm 100 says to give thanks, right? To give thanks. Are you thankful to be in the house of the Lord? Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. There's a lot of people that can't meet in the house of the Lord right now. And we may get there. This thing is ramping up and touching a lot of people. And we have a lot of people out today because we are trying to be safe. They're trying to be safe and think about you. And we need to thank them for that they're thinking about you and they're staying home. They've been in close proximity to people who have tested positive. And so, yes, it is only right that if you're around somebody that's sick, stay home. It's okay. If you're not feeling well, stay home. It's okay. That's why we have these cameras here. You can watch online. And in fact, those of you who are watching online, thank you for watching. Thank you for being a part of our church family. We do miss you being here, but we thank you for continuing to be a part. Please send a message, send a note letting us know that you're watching and that you're with us. We still want to stay connected to you. So please do that. If you have a prayer request, please send in a prayer request. We would be happy to pray for you this week. But thank you so much for watching. All over the place, we have people that watch from Oklahoma, sometimes West Virginia. There's several states that people are watching us from. Several cities, and so we just thank God that the message of his goodness is getting out there. People are interested, and they want to hear. And that's another thing to be thankful for, right? Another thing to be thankful for. Well, we're going to continue on with our Thanksgiving theme here today, and also we're going to continue on next week. We'll have one more message as it relates to Thanksgiving in our sermon series titled Giving Thanks. We're going to continue focusing on Paul's recipe for hope that we find in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, 16 through 18. Last week, you remember that we focused on 16, which said, do you remember what it said? Let me know. Do you remember? Nobody, oh man, the preacher has got to do a better job. Rejoice always. Rejoice always. Verse 17, let's read it all together from verse 16. Let's start. Ready? Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing and give thanks in all circumstances. We're going to focus today on prayer. Praying without ceasing. That sounds like a tall order, doesn't it? Pray without stopping. When something ceases, it stops. It's no longer. Paul tells us never to stop our prayer. How in the world are we supposed to do that? We have lives. We have school. We have jobs. We have family. We have recreation. How in the world are we supposed to pray without stopping? The monks have tried it. They've locked themselves away and they've tried it and they work hard at it. But even the monks have found out that they have to have some purpose in their life, and that purpose is what fuels their prayers. So they work hard at praying without ceasing, but they do it in a particular way. And we're going to talk about prayer today and how we can pray without ceasing. Let me give you just a short example on the ceasing part, okay? When you are at work, some of you work 8-hour shifts, some of you work 12-hour, maybe 14-hour shifts. Denver works all the time. I don't know if he gets a break. He's here today only because they gave him a break. But when we are working, are we moving and are we going about the tasks of our daily jobs every second of every day that we work, in that shift where we work? Are we working every moment of every day? Please let me know by shaking your head. Do you work every moment of every day? No, you don't, do you? You don't. Things come up. Things interrupt you. Things that pertain to work, things that are all involved in working, and sometimes it may be a little conversation that doesn't have necessarily anything to do with work, but that's okay. That's allowed by our bosses, and we do those things. But, you know, when we get home from our long shift, somebody at the house probably asks, what were you doing today? I was at work. I was working, right? So work is a mindset. Work is an attitude. Work is I'm going to work and I'm going to do the best I can to focus on the things that I have promised my employer that I would do. I'm going to focus on them. There's going to be some interruptions. There's going to be things that happen. But nevertheless, I'm going to do my best to work. As long as I'm there, I'm going to give my employer an honest day's work. And that's what Paul is recommending here when it comes to prayer, that we give God an honest day's effort to think about him, to think about him, to communicate with him. This prayer thing can be confusing sometimes. Seems easy to some people. It seems very difficult for others. We took a survey this week. I wanted to know what people thought about prayer. Marcus, my friend, it's good to see you today. Marcus was supposed to be on the video, but we had a glitch, so you're not going to see yourself today. Marcus is a cool dude. I like Marcus. Get to know Marcus before he walks out of this building saying hello to Marcus, all right? Sorry about that, but they're going to do it. They're going to do it. All right. We took a survey. I want you to hear what other people have to think about this prayer thing. Let's play.
What is prayer?
It's when you talk to God.
Prayer is a conversation between me and God.
Prayer is a time with God.
I think prayer is a conversation that you have with God.
Your conversations with God and connecting with him. And
it's like when you pray to God, right?
Asking God for things that you hope will happen in your life or for blessings.
Do you believe prayer works?
Yes, I do.
Yes.
Prayer does work?
Yes.
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 I do.
How do you know it works?
because I've seen God work in my personal life when I have prayed.
Evidence of what I've been praying for come to fruition.
Just because our prayers aren't always answered doesn't mean that prayer doesn't work.
Because sometimes you can see it in your life and sometimes you can just feel the love of God.
When I pray, like if we go to a party or something, I pray for them to get home safe. And they end up getting home safe, somehow, some way.
My friends and my family praying with me. And my dad is 2 years cancer-free and with a 95% chance that he will never get it again.
Yes, those are some thoughts on prayer. I liked Raylan's answer to how do you know prayer works? Because, and then it went on to the next one. I just got that. Because it does. Just believe it. God says it, I believe it, and that settles it. Amen. Amen. A lot of consistent answers there in that survey. We would expect that. Asking people that hang around with us here, we would expect that our answers would be similar, right? And in fact, I would tend to say that even people that aren't hanging around with us, most people pray in some form or some fashion. Some people pray, and they try their best to talk to God, right? That's how we get things. Talk to God. That's how we get things. Or it's how we get out of things. How many have prayed and asked God to get you out of a mess that you got yourself into? Oh, yes. Some of you are going to have to come to the altar because you're not telling the truth. Sometimes we pray to get things. Sometimes we pray to get out of things. I think it's important for us to realize that prayer is important in our lives. And it's a little bit deeper than getting things or getting out of things. I was curious at what some experts might have to say about this thing we call prayer. And so I began doing a little research this week. And any of you familiar with Ravi Zacharias? He's a very, very powerful apologist for the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I want to read to you what he has to say about prayer. Let's bring that up. First thing he does is he says what prayer is not. His prayer is not a grocery list of items that I want or need. It is not about my will. It is not seeking to change the will of God. This is what he says prayer is. Prayer is a constant reminder that the human being is not autonomous. Prayer in its most basic form is the surging of the human spirit in its weakness, grasping at the Spirit of God in his strength. I want you to make a mental note of that phrase, grasping the Spirit of God. There's another expert, famous preacher, famous educator, a famous writer, very powerful ministry back around the turn of the 20th century, so we're going back just a little bit, but I have his little book titled How to Pray, and I looked in there today. Let's read what R.A. Torrey has to say. Prayer is setting your face to find God and obtain blessing from him. God is the source of all blessing, right? So we go to God for that. I want you to make a mental note of setting your face to find God. Now, we would be remiss today if we didn't go to the final and the only real authority on prayer. The disciples asked Jesus, their Lord, teach us how to pray. And this is what Jesus said. We've all memorized this. I want us to read it together. Let's read together. Pray like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Some translations stop there. If you've learned it in the King James, you know that there's a final amen to this. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Jesus instructed his followers to pray. There was an expectation there. Because a little earlier in this chapter, chapter 6, he says, when you pray. When you pray. You see, not only do we pray today, but they prayed back then to God as well. Because they needed some things and they needed to get out of some things. And so they prayed to God too. Jesus says, when you pray, there's an expectation there that we all pray. We all pray, learn to pray, most of us at a young age. We learned through memorization. We learned prayers either through Bible school or through Sunday school or children's church or at the dinner table or at the bedside, right? There's variations to these, but one that I remember is, now I lay me down to sleep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. Do you remember that one? Anybody ever said that one? Yes. We've said that one, right? We memorize that and we say it. And ritualistically go to God in prayer every evening. And many of us recite prayers that are similar. They might not be the same one, but recite prayers that are similar. Remember this one that I learned at the dinner table. God is good. God is great, or the opposite. God is great. God is good. Let us thank him for our food. Amen. A simple prayer. What did it teach us, though, when we learned these prayers as youngsters? What it taught us was that there is a God who is approachable. There is a God that we can talk to. There is a God that we can come to, and he will listen to us. But there's another little calamity that happens with prayers that we memorize as youngsters if we're not careful. And that is that our prayers can instinctively become rote-type prayers that we just say without thinking about them, without any real meaning to them, almost thinking that if I say the right words, then blessings will come to me. If I say it in just the right way, in just the right cadence, God's blessings will come. So it's almost like a formula, or it's almost like a magic potion or something of that nature. If I say it right, God will do his part. We learn it as children. But what our experts have told us today is that prayer is more than just saying words that we have memorized. Ravi Zacharias says, prayer is grasping for the Spirit of God and his strength. Grasping. Trying to obtain something. Trying to get a hold of something. You ever drop something behind the dresser or under the bed and it rolls just far enough that you stick your arm and you just can't reach it? And you, I got to get it. And you wiggle around and you move and you stretch your fingers until you touch it. That's grasping for something. Ravi Zacharias says, prayer is grasping for God. R.A. Torrey says, prayer is setting our face towards God. Turning our face towards God. How many know that there is scripture in the book of Deuteronomy that says that the Lord turns his face to you? It's the blessing of Aaron. He said, the Lord turned his face towards you. The Lord is looking at you. He's looking for you. But what is our position? Are we turned looking at all of the trappings of this world, all the things that confuse our mind and our heart? Or in prayer, are we setting our face towards God, the source of all life, the source of all strength, the source of all hope? Are we setting our face towards him? Or are we just rattling off a few words that we've memorized over the years? You ever been in a crowd where you're looking for a loved one, you're looking for somebody that's important to you? People walking, some people everywhere, and you're looking and you lift your head up above, and you're looking, setting your face towards somebody, and you're hoping in return that somebody is turning their face towards you so that you can make eye contact. Because if you make eye contact, now I can make my way to you, setting my face towards you. When somebody comes into the room, hopefully what we do is we turn around and we set our face towards them and we have a big smile on our face. Welcome to my home. Welcome to my room. I have a friend that when I come into his presence and we make eye contact, it doesn't matter how far away he is, I know he's coming. Big smile on his face. He's coming. He's making his way to me. And a lot of times I'm busy doing things, and so I'm not thinking, right? I know what's going to happen, but I'm not thinking. And so he comes like, hey, buddy, my friend. I won't say his name. Put my hand out, and he slaps my hand away. He grabs onto me, and he gives me the biggest bear hug. Sometimes he takes my breath away. But that's how glad he is to see me. He has set his face towards me. He has grasping for our friendship and our kinship. He's showing me that he's serious about it. That's what prayer is, friends. Grasping for God. Setting our face towards God. Not just saying the right words in the right cadence, in the right order, and expecting God to bless. Not coming to him with our grocery list of items that we need today. You know, we do that a lot. We all do it. We treat God like a vending machine. Don't we? Let's be honest, we do. Get up in the morning. What do I need from God today? And walk over to the vending machine. I need some strength today. E9, I'm going to push the button E9. And I'm going to get me some strength today. I stayed up late the last few nights, and I'm kind of dragging this morning, and I need some energy. Lord, give me some energy today. Maybe we need a good report from the medical doctor. I might not have been eating just right. I might not have been doing exactly what the doctor told me to do. Scott, do you ever have that situation? Oh, yes. But now I'm going to get a report card of how I've been doing. So I'm going to put a prayer out on the prayer chain. Please pray for Pastor John that he gets a good report. It happens. It's okay. God says to cast our cares upon him because he cares for us. There's another portion of Scripture that says, make your requests known to the Lord. So he wants you to make those requests. But never forget that if you want powerful prayer in your life, if you want prayer that has meaning, if you want to see God working in your life in a way you've never seen before, then you set your heart to grasping for him. You set your eyes and your face towards him. Why? Because he's the source of all of those blessings. And he also tells me that he knows what I need. And he will provide what I need. So rather than coming to the vending machine with my grocery list today, maybe I should focus more on grasping a hold of the source of all of those blessings. Let's stop treating the Lord as Mr. Fix-It. Let's start treating the Lord for who he is. He is the source of all life and every blessing. Every good and perfect gift comes from him. Let's press in to him. So as we talk about prayer, we talk about this pressing in, I want to help you understand a little bit about what prayer is. And then we're going to, in a few minutes, we're going to look at the monks and how they consider prayer. And maybe we can learn something today. Maybe God can show us something different about this thing we call prayer. The first thing I want you to know is that prayer is a matter of faith. Prayer is a matter of faith. If you're coming to God, you're coming to him believing that he invites you to come. And even before you come to him, you must determine in your heart and your mind that there is a God that has answers that you need, that is the source of what your needs are. And so coming to him is a matter of faith. Coming to him and not being worried that you're going to end up as a pile of dust from being in his presence, that's a matter of faith. Hebrews 11:6 says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. But never forget the last part of that. It says, God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Are we diligently seeking his face? Prayer is not just a matter of faith, it's a matter of humility. To come to the Almighty God, we better humble ourselves. In the scriptures, several times when the word prayer is used, supplication is also used. Prayer and supplication, a humbling of myself before God. I realize who He is, and I for sure know who I am, and so I need to humble myself. James chapter 4, verse 10 says, to humble yourself before God, and He will lift you up. He will exalt you. There's another portion of scripture that says that God resists the proud, but He lifts up the humble. When we come to Him in pride, when we come to Him with the wrong heart, I think what God does in resisting us is just makes us our prayers noise. Wah, 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 wah. Charlie Brown, right? Wah, 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 wah. That's probably what it sounds like to God. You see, the reason for that is that prayer is a matter of heart. It's a heart attitude. He's not my sugar daddy. He's just my daddy. And I go to my daddy because He knows what I need and He knows how to help me to get there. Sometimes I need blessing. Sometimes I need favor. Sometimes I need healing, but sometimes I need discipline. And sometimes I need a little scolding. That's what daddies do. But it's all for my good. It's all to build my character. Remember yet last week, chapter 5 of Romans, these sufferings, these hard times, they build our endurance, and our endurance develops character, and our character develops hope. When we go to a daddy, there's a hope because there's a hard attitude, knowing that He loves me and knowing that He wants what is best for me. I want to talk a little bit more about this heart condition. It's a matter of heart. So when we are coming to God and our heart condition is right, what we are doing, friends, is we are grasping for God. We're setting our face towards Him. It's an important part of our prayer life. And too often, I think we get too busy. And it's like flipping a switch. We turn the switch on, and then, God, here's what we need today. Blah, 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 blah. Do, 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 do. This is what we need, and do this, and do this, and bless this person, bless that person. Take care of our country. Okay, I checked everything off. Boom, I'm done, and I'm gone. There's an important part of our facet of prayer that we leave out too often, and that's the pressing in to a daddy. Pressing in. All right, Tori has another comment about this heart condition and heart attitude. He says, much of our modern prayer has no power in it because it has no heart in it. Much of our modern prayer has no power in it because it has no heart in it. I see a lot of people today that need some victory in their life. They need something a little bit more than what they're depending on to carry them through. And every one of us is talking to God in some way, shape, or form. But we leave out the most important part, which is with all of our heart, pressing in to God. Pressing into Him first. Pressing into Him before a word is ever spoken. How do we do that? The monks work really hard at that. Let's take a look at how the monks approach prayer. The first thing that happens in the prayer life of a monk is that they spend time in contemplation. You've heard me use the phrase pressing in to God. There are no words being spoken here. Contemplating, they are pondering God. They are pondering His goodness. They are pondering His benefits. They are pondering the attributes that are holy. They are pure and they are just towards us. They press in to God. No words. The next thing they do is they meditate. No words. Meditation's got a bad rap over the last few decades, over the last maybe more than a few decades. New Age movement come along, and there's a lot of meditation, and so we kind of shy away from the word meditation. But it's in the Scripture. The word meditation is in the Scripture. Psalm chapter 1, verse 1 says, tells us to meditate. If we want to be successful, if we want to be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, bringing forth its fruit in due season, it says to meditate on the law of the Lord. Meditate on what He says. Meditate on His instructions. One of my favorite writers is A.W. Tozer. He's written a lot of classic books, but he has a heart for God. He wrote a book called In Pursuit of God. It's a classic. He describes in his books his prayer time. And when he gets to the meditation part, he's reading the Scriptures. He's reading the Psalms. He's praying. He prays them in his mind. But he also reads, he has an old hymn book, and he reads the old hymns, because the old hymns have a lot of truth in them. So he is contemplating God first, just like the monks do. He is meditating, pondering, listening to God. What does God have to say to me about this stuff that I am meditating on? My life, my job, my problems, my family, my hopes, my dreams, before a word is ever said. Then, and only then, do they move to vocal petitions and intercessions for others. We live in a microwave society. Pop it in the microwave for 30 seconds. Let's get this over with. If we have to wait more than a few minutes on our food at a restaurant, we get upset. They ought to have it done. Our prayer should never be microwave prayer. That's where we draw our strength. It's where we draw on revelation. Because you know this meditation part happens in isolation most of the time. Isolation, when it's totally quiet. That's when we can hear God the best. Not with noise, not with the noise of life, not with the chaos that so encircles us throughout our day, but when we steal away and we get alone with God just for a few moments, that's when we can hear Him. When we are in a devotion time and we're seeking to study, and we're reading the Scriptures and we're seeking to study, that's a wonderful thing and a wonderful discipline for us to be a part of. But if we never ponder, if we never consider, then all we're doing is seeking knowledge. But friends, God has given us an avenue called prayer to where we can move from the things being taught to the things that we can catch or be caught. We can move from being taught to the things God will give us that can be caught. That's revelation. When we receive revelation, our hearts and minds are transformed. John the Revelator was all alone on an island. He was being punished for his faith in Jesus. That's the very place God used to reveal the things of the end. Jesus came to him personally, face to face, and said, "Let me tell you, my friend, let me tell you some things. Let me show you some things." What wonderful things. That book of Revelation is talked about probably more than about any book in the Bible. Daniel was also in isolation. Daniel had been taken away from his family. He'd been taken away from his nation. He was serving a heathen king. It's a trying situation. What did he do? He pressed into God 3 times a day. Morning, noon, and night, he pressed into God. He defied the orders of the king. And he pressed into God. God showed Daniel things that no other man could see. God showed him secrets that changed the very trajectory of the nation of Israel. He spoke about things to come, even for you and I. Revelation comes after a contemplation and after a meditation. Don't sell it short. Don't sell it short. It's the source. God is a source. So we move to Him. We grasp for Him. We set our faces towards Him. And all of those laundry lists of things that I have on my heart, they begin to fade away in the presence of the Almighty God. He'll take care of them as He needs to take care of them. But my strength, my hope, my character, my endurance is all based on this grace that I find at the feet of God Almighty in His presence. Do we want Him more than we've ever wanted anything else in our life? Do we want Him more? Think about this. The God of the universe has made Himself available to you. And all He wants from you is the privilege of you pressing into Him. Pressing in. Pressing in like a daughter might press into her daddy when she needs a hug. Pressing in when a father and a son, maybe they go fishing, or maybe they're pitching and catching a ball. There's not a whole lot of words. There's not a whole lot of communication. That's what we think because we don't hear anything. But man, that communication is powerful. There's security and there's safety. And there's a base for joy and happiness that only comes from that moment. Don't shortchange yourself in your prayer life by going directly to your list of concerns and cares. Press in. Press into the source of everything that concerns you. He knows what you need. And He's ready to respond. Guys, this is not on the slide, but I want to go to Jeremiah. Israel was in trouble with God, and they were being disciplined. But God wanted to remind them of some things that I believe can also pertain to us. This promise is not just for the children of Israel, but it's for His children. I believe that. In Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11, God tells His children, I've got plans for you. I've got plans for you. Even in the suffering, even in the challenges, I've got plans for you. Plans for good and not evil. To give you a future. To give you a hope. Verse 12 says, you will call on me and come and pray to me. Do you see the movement there? You will call on me, you will come to me. And you will pray. And I will hear you. You will seek me and you will find me when you seek me with all of your heart. I'm challenging you today, friends, to press into God. Press into God. You will not be disappointed. Those things that have been troubling you for so long, they will begin fading. The victory that you've been calling on God for maybe is right there for the taking. All He needs from you is that you leave your concerns for that victory and you press into God, and the victory will take care of itself. So often I have prayed to God about a circumstance and I say, God, can you change this circumstance? And I'm promising you, every time I pray that prayer in love, he responds to me and says, why don't we change you? Why don't we change you? I know it sounds a little kooky, this pressing in thing. It sounds a little odd, but it's really not. Would you give me just a moment and let me take you through that today so that as you leave this place, you have an idea of what it means to press in. Press in like that. In your mind and in your heart, I want you to press into God. Give him a big bear hug and let him give you one back. Would you bow your heads? Would you close your eyes? I'm going to talk you through it, but when you do this on your own, there are no words. He knows your heart. He knows what you're thinking. What does Jesus say in Matthew chapter 6? He says, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Think about his wonderful name. Think about how special he is. Give him a big bear hug. Lord, you're special. There is none like you, Lord. There is no one like you, Lord. You are so faithful to me. You are so good to me. I count on that mercy that you provide me every day. I count on that love and those promises. It says your love endures forever. Press in to him. Let him press in to you. The more you do this, friends, the more victory you're going to have in your life. The more you do this, friends, those troubles and those cares are going to fade away in the presence of the Almighty. As the song said this morning, there's a breakthrough coming. Don't seek the breakthrough. Seek the source of all life. Rest in his grace. After we have contemplated, after we have grasped for him, we begin pondering the things that he tells us. We begin pondering the things within our heart. And we just might say something like this. And you can sing it along with me. Knowing you, Jesus. Knowing you. There is no greater thing. You're my all. You're the best. You're my joy, my righteousness. And I love you, Lord. Will you sing it with me? Knowing you, Jesus. Knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness, and I love you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. We press into you, Jesus. We don't want anything in return, Jesus. We just want you. Do you feel his presence? Do you sense his loving kindness towards you? Are the things that you've been worried about this week, are they fading away? in the presence of your King. Isolation is where you will catch revelation. There's a reason the scripture says, be still and know that I am God. This pressing in is an effort to be still. And to know, and to let him be God. Let him be who he wants to be in your life. If you maintain this heart attitude at various times throughout your day, then you offer up your thoughts, your prayers, your intercession, in the moments that you get throughout your day, you will be able to pray without ceasing. Press in. See what he wants to do in your life. Would you stand this morning? I hope that God has revealed something maybe new to you today, maybe a little different today. Forget about your laundry lists for a few days. Set your face on knowing him and see what happens with the rest of the things you're worried about. Would you join me in singing that chorus one last time? Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness. Sing that again. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness, and I love you, Lord. With all of your hearts, press into him as you say it. And I love you, Lord. Lord Jesus, we love you. We recognize you for who you are today. There is none like you. There is none like you, Lord. Forgive us for coming to you and presenting our laundry list day after day after day, never, ever shutting up long enough to allow you to reveal yourself to us. But today is a new day. We want to commit as we leave this building. We want to commit to knowing you. We want to commit to pressing in to you. Teach us how, Lord. Show us the way. You know what needs to be done. We place our trust in you, knowing that you will do it and your will be accomplished in our lives. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Isn't it good to be in the presence of God Almighty today? Amen. Thank you so much for being here today. Please keep your friends and family in prayer. Please be safe. Be safe and do what you can to protect others. Go from this place and impact your world for Christ. That is our mission. That is our call. You are dismissed. Thank you so much for being here.